cross the fence, talking about atheism, talking about the gaps that evolution, I just don't know how that jumps these gaps, talking about the difference between how evolution and creation shapes your mind and your life and your engagement with the world. That's what we do for the next 15 minutes. Hope you enjoy. All right. Hey, welcome to Cross the Fence. I'm your host, Pastor Brian Wolfmuller. I can't believe Ian started the music. I'm still writing notes here for the show. This is the show, by the way, every week where we endeavor to ignite your theological imagination by thinking about how beautiful and good the theology, the Lord's word, the Lord's doctrine, the stuff that God says to us is the best stuff. It's the best thing we can think about. It's the best thing we can talk about. It's the best thing we can consider. And that's what we try to do here on Cross the Fence. That's what we're after anyways. I'm your host, Pastor Brian Wolfmuller, the pastor of Hope Lutheran Church here in Aurora, Colorado. And here's the plot for today. Thanks for listening, by the way. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for downloading the podcast, if you're downloading the podcast. If you've missed previous episodes, you can find all the podcasts and all the past stuff at kfuo.org and a bunch of other theological stuff at wolfmuller.co. But here's the thing. It's April 1st today, which means as we're recording the show. So what we want to do is think about atheism and evolution. That's what you do on April the 1st. So we're going to talk about a few things. I've got just a couple of sort of unformed thoughts. I'm hoping they will evolve as we talk them through. And then, second part of the show, Pastor Scott Stigmeyer from Concordia Irvine is going to join us to talk about transhumanism, which is something I do not know anything about, but ask me in an hour, and I'll know something that's going on. So that's the plot. Thanks for joining in. Now, we know, the Lord says in the beginning that God created the heavens and the earth. That's the text in Genesis, and there's so much there. It's this great thing where, you know, when you want to understand something, there's basically four questions that you want to ask to get your head around something. Where'd it come from? Where's it going? What's its form? What's its matter? Aristotle taught us those four questions. They're four good questions to ask, and I was reading old Luther the other day, and he was talking about humanity, and Aristotle's view of humanity says, look, the problem is Aristotle didn't know where man came from or where he was going. It's one of the great gifts of the Holy Scripture that the Bible actually tells us where we came from, namely that we and everything else that we see around us was created by God. Now, that means a lot of things. That just the very fact that we are created tells us so many things. Number one, it tells us that there is a creator, that there is someone greater than ourselves, that there's a purpose and a design to this world, which is obvious when we start to look around. But there are always competing cosmologies or competing stories of creation that are always offering alternative explanations to how we came to be and how everything came to be. And various different philosophers, various different people, had various different explanations for how we came to be throughout human history. So there's always been a fight over that question, how did we get here? Now the fight that we fight in our day is against evolution, because that's the popular cosmology of our own day. That's the quote accepted narrative or story about how we got to where we are to now. And that is the evolutionary idea that through a long period of time, through gradual change, that you started with nothing, and now, voila, look at what we have here today. Now, I'm certainly no philosopher. I'm also no scientist. But I am a human being, and so I think I'm allowed to think about these things. And I'd like to take up this reflecting on evolution in two kind of distinct phases. Number one, I'd like to just suggest that there's some gaps that, you know, evolution wants to connect the dots. One of the great sort of icons of evolution is that picture of you have like a little tadpole, and then the little tadpole grows legs, and then it's like a walking fish and a lizard, and then it gets more and more complex till you get a monkey, and then the monkey becomes like a caveman looking dude, and then it's a guy with a briefcase. You know that picture of the picture of evolution. And this is the evolution idea, is that you can draw a line from one thing to another, a line from the simple to the complex. But I think that, at least in my own mind, and I'm sure there's more, but there's at least five places that we can observe, that the normal human being can observe, where you just cannot connect the dots. There's a gap, and you can't get from one to another. There's no slow process of change and manipulation and whatever to get from one to another. It's like a switch. It's either on or it's off. And it's the gap between zero and one, the gap between one and two, the gap between two and one, the gap between death and life, the gap between unconscious and conscious. So here, I'm gonna list the gaps. The first is the gap between zero and one. That is the gap between nothing and something. How do you go from nothing to something? It is, as far as we can tell, a scientific impossibility. It's also a metaphysical impossibility and it's impossible to go from nothing to something. That there was all of a sudden nothing, and then all of a sudden there was not nothing. It's self-contradictory. Not only do we go from nothing to something, we go from nothing to everything. That's not from zero to one. It's from one to whatever, however you want to count all the things that exist, and you just can't get there. How do you do it? Now, it's sometimes called the first mover argument or the first cause argument, and it's a classic theistic argument that goes all the way back to when the old Greeks were arguing against the atheists, and they said everything had to come from somewhere. Now, we believe, according to the scriptures, from the Genesis and the Psalms and the New Testament, that God created the world ex nihilo. That means out of nothing. So that before there was nothing, there was God, and God created everything. So that there's something from nothing because God is the one who does it. But how do you get there without God? How do you jump that gap, my friends? I just don't know. Second gap, we got to move fast here. I'm looking at the clock. The clock. How do you go? No time to time? I don't know how to do that. The second one is, how do you go from death to life? How do you move from something not being alive, like a rock, to something being alive, like a tree? There's so much involved from that move from one thing to another. There's so many little intricacies that are collected in that move that it seems just impossible to me. It's a leap that's too far. The other one that's interesting, that someone was pointing this out to me. In fact, I was listening to an old Radio Lab podcast, and they were meditating on this. How do you go from one cell to two cells? And what's in between that? To go from one to two, to be able to be something that's standing there on its own to something that's actually able to reproduce itself. And all the things that are involved in the multiplication of a cell. I mean, you have, it's one of the things that's not on my little list here, but the idea that there's energy, or sorry, that there's information and communication that happens, and that has to happen even on a molecular basis for one cell to become two cells. Here's a fourth thing. How do you go from asexual to sexual reproduction? That's the gap between two and one. How do you go from simply one thing being able to reproduce itself, like a cell, to having it, the necessity of having a male and a female for there to be a child? I mean, you just think about it. If there, so say all the just kind of suspend disbelief for a little bit and say the world resulted in an Adam that evolved, but it also didn't result in an Eve that evolved. Well, how are you going to have children? How do you make that jump from being able to self-reproduce to needing sexual reproduction? It just, again, it's a gap that I don't see how you can conceptually cross it. And then the fifth one for us to meditate on is the gap between consciousness and unconsciousness, self-awareness, which has to do with the formation of language and the capacity to reflect on your own thoughts. How do you move from being unconscious to conscious? Now, perhaps there's people who've been sitting there thinking about how you get from one of these things to another, and they might have an answer. But I think that all together we see that there's all these leaps that an evolutionary way of thinking would require. That really, I mean, and this is maybe the point, is that you are really taking a leap of faith. It's one of the things that every time I encounter an evolutionist, they're always despising the Christians for taking a leap of faith. But when we start to see all these gaps that the evolutionist wants us to take, we start to recognize that they are the ones that are taking all of these leaps, that are making all of these jumps. Now, what's the effect on this? This is the thing that's very interesting to me, because we know that ideas have consequences, that the way that you think of the world actually matters in the way that you live, and that there's a difference. Now, stick with me on this one. There's a difference if you are a Christian and you believe that God created the world as it talks about in Genesis in 6 days, saying, let there be light, and let the sky and water be separated, let the land and water be separated. Then he fills the lights with stars and moon and skies, or stars, moon, and the sun, and he fills the sky and the water with birds and with fish, and then God fills the land with beasts and with Adam and Eve, and he creates the animals according to their kind and has them be fruitful and multiply and so forth. And so we see that picture in Genesis, and that gives us an idea of how we got here. And if you think that that's how the world came to be, you live and you interact with the world in a certain particular way. On the other hand, if you believe that we are simply the result of an explosion, some sort of very old, very violent explosion, some big bang, and we are the result of random mutations and the peak of the survival of the fittest, that also makes you live in a certain way. It gives you a certain ethic. It gives you a certain way of living in the world. And I want to just... This is the chart I was working on. I didn't get to finish it here before Ian started the music there, but I want to just kind of break this down by comparison. So that on the one hand, just so creation and evolution, if you can imagine it in two different columns, on the one hand, creation says that all the world was created for a purpose. Now, what's that purpose? It's not maybe obvious in the world, but we can understand that the purpose is God's glory and also now man's salvation. Evolution says that everything came to be according to chance. The creation says that this world, there's a design in this world. Evolution says that everything is an accident, including you. Now, this is the thing, that you are a chance accident. So there's no meaning in life. There's no value, which is what we require. I mean, we require value. Whenever we think, whenever we speak, whenever we act, there's a requirement of a judgment there, which has to do with human dignity, which is given to us in our creativeness, now in createdness. And if we don't have that, it's lost. Creation, now here, think about this one. Creation says that the world came about through the speaking of God. God said, let there be light. And that is not accidental. That God is the one who uses the mechanism of language and of words and of speech to create the world. Evolution says that there's no words at all. It's all simply a giant explosion. Creation says that the world came about in peace, whereas evolution says that the world came about in violence. And with that, that creation says that all this world exists through life, whereas evolution says that all of this is coming about through death. That's the mechanism that Darwin supposedly discovered, the survival of the fittest, which says that this life is a competition for limited resources. That's, again, what evolution says, that life is a competition for various resources, whereas we understand that this world is given to us as a gift for our stewardship. Now, that is different. So that creation teaches an ethic of love, whereas evolution teaches an ethic of survival. And creation teaches that death is unnatural, whereas evolution says that death is natural, the most natural thing of all. Now, this gives you a totally different way of looking at the world. It matters. If you believe that this world was originally created by God as a garden in which our first parents lived, or if you think that we scraped and clawed our way out of the swamp and by overcoming all sorts of other various creatures. One sets us in this world to actually love and serve and bless our neighbor, while the other sets us in the world to do our best just to make it. One understands this world to be a robust place, whereas the other understands that that life itself is fragile and hanging on an edge and could be destroyed at any moment. One exalts strength, whereas the other exalts order, law, justice, compassion. So that, and I know this is going to sound funny, but even if evolution were true, which of course it's not, I mean, it's kind of an absurdity. It's like the biggest hoax ever. But even if it were true, we would have to act like it weren't true just to be human, just to be able to be good to one another, just so the survival of the fittest would not work its way into our ethic, into our thinking, and into our dealing with one another. Anyway, that's what I think. So let us praise God that we're created. And not only are we created, but we're redeemed by the Lord Jesus Christ. We are fallen creation, but the Lord wasn't pleased to let us stay fallen. He came after us to get us, not so that we'll be further evolved, but so that one day we'll be resurrected. I hope that's helpful. Thinking about the gaps that evolution can't answer and thinking about the difference between the two cosmology. Let's go to the break now. I see you got Pastor Stigmeyer on the phone. So we're going to go to the break and we're going to bring him on. I want to just catch a couple of his thoughts on creation and evolution and then see what this transhumanism stuff is. So stick with us through the music, through a couple of commercials. We'll be right back. You're listening to Cross Defense.